Welcome to the bullpen. Yep, in the bullpen today, we have Mr. David McGarry, commentator Young Voices. David is a consumer choice fellow with Young Voices, and his work has appeared in the American Spectator, Real Clear Policy, and the American Conservative. I actually read some of his work. Agree with more than I thought I would, to be honest. Mr. McGarry, welcome to Indisputable. How are you?
I'm doing well, thank you. Thank you for having me on.
Absolutely. All right. So we're going to chop it up about mass shootings in America and the government's response to it. I don't want to presume what you know or believe about that topic. So if you would, give us your sentiment and I will then opine.
Yeah, thank you very much. So as you said, I don't expect that we're going to agree on everything today, but I hope that we can find some places of agreement. And that in the places we disagree, your audience can find some clarity on these really important issues. So my primary argument about America's mass shooting problem is that we need to spend a little bit more time thinking about it with more consideration and less emotion than we typically do in our nation's national discourse. So first of all, I'd like to point out that mass shootings in this country are just one of three distinct crises of gun violence that we have. According to Pew Research in the year, or from the year of 2020, 54% of all gun deaths were from suicide, and 43% were from murder. And mass shootings made up only 0.2% of the gun deaths, or I should say what the FBI terms active shooter incidents were responsible for 0.2% of all of those murders. Now, that is in no way to downplay the significance or the horror of incidents such as occurred in Uvalde or in Highland Park or in Buffalo, those three most recently, but it's rather to put it in a larger context. And since everyone wants to save lives, everyone wants to make sure that American citizens and American children and the American people in general can live safe, happy, and secure lives, We should put the mass shootings in the larger context that they deserve, so that we can actually find some find some solutions. Now, those solutions to these problems. Also, I think we have a national confusion regarding what how to find these solutions. First off, we don't focus enough on the fact that our nation doesn't enforce the gun laws that we already have, and it's a cliche to say at this point, but it's true. And simply going straight to Congress, as many people who have microphones or Twitter accounts tend to do, we should look at the law enforcement agency's response to gun crimes. I mean, just take the police response in Uvalde as the prime example and the latest example of total failure. And we should also look to institutions of civil society as well to create an environment in which we can live safe, happy lives while still respecting constitutional rights.
Okay. All right, so let me go down the number narrative because you presented that first. Do you know how many mass shootings have happened in America this year thus far?
Well, I can't answer that question because what a mass shooting is entirely depends on your definition of that. So let me ask you, sir, how are you defining mass shootings? Because different research outlets will put different numbers on that.
Yeah, the majority of research institutions and the FBI, as well as the Gun Archive, they define a mass shooting as when four or more people are actually shot, injured during a shooting. That's what they classify.
And just to be clear, that's shot, meaning, as you said, injured, not necessarily killed.
That's correct. That is the definition of a mass shooting, that people are shot in mass shooting. So that's the definition. 350 individuals so far in the United States of America, far outpaces any other country, even when you adjust for population density and countries that have a massive population. Now, that's problematic in America. So your 0.2% number is right most years, by the way. That's an aggregate count, it does fluctuate. But let's talk about the reason why policy is important and why there should be an appropriate government response. we typically weigh these things based on the impact to society. We understand that if a person is, let's say, hit physically, right? That has a different impact on society, a different impact on the individual. There's a criminal penalty for that. There's a punishment for that. But it's not the same punishment as if you killed somebody or attempted to kill somebody. Why? Because when you kill someone, the impact to society is great, even if it is a smaller percentage based on the comparative data of other gun crimes. Let's go to Texas, for example, specific issue in Texas. We're talking policy. In Texas, the mass shooter was able to get a weapon that could commit great carnage at a very young age. How was he able to get this weapon when it's actually prohibited by Texas law? He was able because there was a loophole in the policy. If your parent vouched for you, if a parent or guardian vouched for you, you were then able to obtain this kind of weaponry. Texas already said in the legislature, 18-year-olds don't need this kind of gun. But then in order to appease the gun lobby, in order to appease the red meat Republicans, they decided to create a loophole in that law where if a parent said yes, you can still get it. Now remember, the parent that signed off on this was aware that his son had an issue with violence. He was involved or was aware of a police encounter where there was allegedly violence in the home, but he still signed off on it. And when he was questioned about it, he said, you know, they told me to sign it. They did a background check and he got approved. Not my fault, all right? The point I'm making to you is that one change in the legislative dynamic for Texas, with all things even, dear brother, would have stopped that 18-year-old from obtaining that weapon. Am I right or wrong on that?
I think you in theory are right. But as I said, I think that we have a problem with the enforcement of gun laws. So even when they're in place, they are not always people slip through the cracks, I should say. Now, one thing I will say,
Wait a minute.
I want to compliment you for a second.
Okay, go ahead. Yeah, you can do that all day, brother. Go ahead.
I want to agree with you because if you also look at the Highland Park shooter, he actually had police call to his house and they confiscated knives and swords from him because he had made threats towards his parents. His parents then refused to sign statements that would have prompted further legal action. And then his father signed off on a necessary form for him to get a permit to buy a gun. So I actually entirely agree with you that the family response to this is really, really important. And this is something that I've been banging my spoon on my high chair, if you will, about because I think that families and communities need to really spend the time with their alienated youth, and they need to be in touch with them. And it's not even just about preventing a mass shooting, though I do think it would do that. But just for the sake of these lost teenagers who are in so much pain, families, like I said, families and churches and synagogues and mosques and schools need to be more in touch with their kids who seem to be at risk for this sort of behavior.
All right.
So I could not agree with you more there.
So let me respond to the dynamic you mentioned about the enforcement element. People are still going to fall through the cracks as far as enforcement, if enforcement is not there. Here's the thing, there are some murderers, dear brother, who are going to fall through the cracks this year. They're gonna kill people, they're gonna get away with it this year, all right? They may get caught later. That's no reason to say we cannot enact policy or law against killers and make sure that we hold them accountable when we catch them, even if they fall through the cracks sometimes. Another thing, I understand your aspirational point of view as it relates to parenting, but I don't pay those parents. The citizens of this nation pay taxes. They pay taxes, and much of that tax money goes to support a governmental infrastructure that's inclusive of policymakers we call elected officials. Those are the people that are accountable to me because I pay them. Now, I get your point. That point is separate from a policy dynamic, because I would like my money that I work for, and they take it out of my paycheck so that they can pay their salaries. I need them to be accountable to creating good policy that makes sense to communities that I love.
I entirely agree with you in principle. What I will say, however, is that you can enact any gun legislation, no matter how comprehensive or how well crafted. It will do no good if it's not enforced. And then,
well, that goes for any legislation, dear brother.
Of course it does.
Any legislation, not just guns.
But I think we're violently agreeing again.
Okay.
Because for any legislation, if anything is criminalized, just look at the federal federal regulations around marijuana. To a large extent, the reason why states are able to legalize pot the way that they are is because the feds have a policy of benign neglect. And you can also read my writing for why why federal marijuana laws are just completely ridiculous and crazy and unconstitutional in a lot of cases. But I entirely agree with you. I think that we need to, for any law, new, old, proposed, or what have you, we need to enforce it. And I think that we clearly have a problem where laws aren't being enforced. And therefore, it seems to me that either in tandem or before putting new laws in place, we have to start enforcing what we have. So, for example, one mind-boggling statistic is that out of 112,000 prohibited persons, I believe this was in 2017, out of 112,000 prohibited persons who tried to pass a federal background check illegally, the number of prosecutions was 12. That is insane. That is absolutely insane. And with that kind of enforcement, if you have a 1 out of 10,000 chance of getting punished for that kind of behavior, of course people are going to engage in it.
Okay. All right, let me ask you this question. We only have a few minutes left before the next show. In one of your writings, you highlighted the phraseology that was shared by Justice Clarence Thomas in the guns decision, okay? And you said, listen, this is about self-defense. Do you still stand by that? That the decision that took away New York's ability to restrict guns in a particular area was about self-defense, and that this self-defense is in fact constitutional?
Well, I want to be very clear,
okay,
and sort of be very precise in my answer to that question. So, what Bruin's decision stated was not that guns could not be regulated, but simply that if you check the boxes at the end of the road, the state shall issue you a permit. Now, going back to your question about self-defense, I understand that the word self-defense do not appear in the Second Amendment. That is true. I will give you that. I will concede that. However, with that said, self-defense, if you go back to the debates of the time, if you go back to even before the founding of America, if you go back to the common law tradition from which we got so many of our principles and our ideas of what are rights, if you go back to the writings of William Blackstone, I think you will find that self-defense is actually an integral part of our rights. And even though it was not the primary concern when the Second Amendment was being drafted, of the concern of James Madison when he wrote the Second Amendment, of course, was to establish the militia as a bulwark against government. Even the militia was understood as being the outgrowth of an individual right to keep and bear arms. And this was evidenced by the fact, by the way, that during the time of the ratification of the Constitution, there were conversations that were had by Federalists and Anti-Federalists speaking about the fact that the primary way in which a oppressive government would disarm a militia would be to disarm the private citizens and then let the institution falter, as it were.
All right, let me give you a correction to James Madison. James Madison did not have the same sentiment as the Virginia version of the adopted wording. He wanted to stop a national army. That was kind of a general sentiment. This was literally about having a well-armed militia for James Madison. So there was a split in that. I understand your contextualization of the standards in New York. The reality is New York should have the authority to regulate these, to regulate gun rules or regulate gun laws. And the court kind of agreed. It just said their standard was not objective enough for them. All right. Thank you, brother. It's a good debate. I appreciate you being
here. Thank you so much. I appreciate you having me on and hearing me out.
Absolutely, man. Anytime.